As I indicated, this is a dream come true for Cass County, so I'm just so pleased that we're able to present Dr. Weller. And I was telling him I started as a prosecutor in the 80s, back when we had shoulder pads and big hair and all that. I still like the music from the 70s, but anyways, you know, we had this, everybody needs to go to jail, and I agree that jail is certainly an alternative and something that has to work hand in hand in the criminal justice system as well as a prison. But when I became a judge in the 90s, I started seeing the same families, and I'm thinking, well, what did I do wrong in the 80s? I mean, why is this repeating, and what are we doing wrong? And when Barb and I first started the treatment court in 2001 in Cass County, we got to really be educated and see that addiction is a health issue, and bringing our collaborative partners together to make a difference in our families. So when we mention the fact that there are 80 children in foster care since October as a result of drugs, and it is now equally split in Cass County between methamphetamine and opiates. What does that say about the community? Well, it says a lot that it's a serious health epidemic, and that addiction is a health problem that we can work hand in hand with our medical professionals, our community mental health professionals, our law enforcement professionals, our police officers, in making a difference for our families. Dr. Weller, who is present today, and we're so fortunate to have him, is an addiction and pain and emergency medicine specialist and a senior medical director for education and policy at the Camden Coalition of Healthcare Providers. Prior to that, he worked at Spectrum Health Systems in Grand Rapids, which is a fully integrated health system with 11 hospitals and over 1,000 medical doctors. He was the medical director of the Spectrum Health Medical Group, Center for Integrative Medicine, the medical staff chief of pain medicine to Spectrum Health Hospital Systems. And I know he's going to tell you he keeps taking pay reductions to work in the system because it means a lot to him. He was the president of the Michigan Society of Addiction Medicine as well as the SUD medical director at the Lakeshore Regional Partners, which is the group that oversees the medical or the Medicaid substance abuse issues for his region, which included Kent County at the time. He earned a master's of science in neuromolecular biology. I practiced that because I'm a poli-sci major at Southwest Texas State University, and he earned his medical degree at the University of Texas Medical School in San Antonio. He also completed his emergency medicine residency at Thomas Jefferson University in Philadelphia and is, of course, board certified in addiction medicine. I've had the opportunity, this will be my third time to see Dr. Weller, and I'm still very, very excited about this opportunity. And I don't see things three times other than Gone with the Wind, so I'm just very excited that he's here. His special interests include creating a comprehensive workforce development suite for the care of complex, high-cost patients, understanding the biophysical and social and financial impact of high-cost, complex patients, which that's who we're serving, as well as the unique interaction of pain and addiction. Please welcome Dr. Weller.
Thank you. All right, so basically all that boils down to is nerd, all right? That's, it just means I like to learn, I hate problems that are not solved, and really enjoy helping other really smart people solve those problems and being able to do that. So I had put, everybody always asks for a PowerPoint when I do a presentation. You need it for CEUs and you need it for, you know, all of those things. And I really have an internal disdain for PowerPoints. And so we will go through these three slides, but we will have basically one slide up for the entire time that I talk. More than welcome to look at the remainder of the slides. We will touch on some of that stuff, but we have a really varied audience today. So I'm not here to teach you about how to prescribe a medication. I'm not here to teach you about how to think about this from a social active, you know, action standpoint or what the policy is. I'm here to do all of those things so that we can understand that we have everybody in the room in Cass County to fix this problem. And I will convince you by the end that this is a fixable problem, that this is not something that we just have to throw our hands up and be angry about. And as someone who lectures on behavioral health and chronic pain and addiction for a living, I will do my best to make it not the saddest talk you've ever heard, right? Because, you know, that I want to build a, architectural, workforce development tool. What that means is we're building a website with about 90 hours worth of training on it for free for addiction, pain, and behavioral health that's going to have be for everybody from the patient all the way up to the prescriber. And that website goes live in the next few months, and it's complex.care, www.complex.care. And that's funded by Robert Wood Johnson, Kresge Foundation, and those. And the goal with that is to make sure that we can all get on the same page. Because one of the things that I found very early on in my career is that the education that I was given did not enable me to have a conversation with a person that did not have that same education. We could be talking about the exact same disease and not understand a word of each other. I've worked for the police department. I've worked as the medical director for Grand Rapids Special Response Team, or their SWAT team, for a decade. I worked for the same for Philly, and I worked in the Federal Protective Service as a tactical physician. So I've worked in and around law enforcement for a long period of time and have a viewpoint that I know that there is an enforcement reality of what we have to do, but it was always frustrating when you think about what enforcement looks like, followed by, man, if we had just gotten somebody to fix this problem, we wouldn't have to be knocking down this door and going into this house with these families and these scared kids and these other people that are there. I mean, everybody thought that who was doing that, but you have a job. The job in that world is enforcement. And those in the that are judges or are juries, that's for adjudication. They determine what is the appropriate punishment for that crime, right? And so we have roles that we each play in society, and one of the things that I want everybody to learn is embrace your role. As a doctor, it took me a long time to learn that I'm not a judge. It's not my job. But I would get frustrated with judges when I first started working with them because they wouldn't, in my mind, they wouldn't listen to me. But what I found is that what I was trying to do was tell them how to do their job, not just what the medicine means and what this means for a patient. And then the minute that they understood that they're not a doctor and I'm not a judge, this started to work. And we had conversations. So the goal is to be able to have conversations about addiction, about chronic pain, about communities, and an understanding that addiction by itself is a chronic neurobiological disorder that lives here. This is it. It is a chronic neurobiological disorder. It is not a decision. It is not a bad day. It is not just a person who used cocaine once. It's not a positive urine drug screen. It's not somebody who got angry and left and got drunk one night. It's not. We define addiction based on 11 criteria. 9 of those are behaviors. 2 of those are physiological phenomena. So if we define this disease based on maladaptive behaviors, those behaviors that happen that shouldn't happen, if we define it that way, then should it be of any surprise that people with this disease have behaviors that are different than what we would hope, that are irritating, that frustrate us? As a family member, as a provider, or as a law enforcement officer, those behaviors have to be expected. So one of the goals that I have, in this talk is to really make sure that everybody here understands why that behavior happens, and that it's not somebody creating a pros and cons list of, if I act like an a-hole, that'll be super awesome. That doesn't happen, right? What they do, they're not thinking about that. It's like, teenagers when they're 15 or whatever, they're like freaking out. It's not, they didn't come up with a pros and cons list of freaking out. They're just like freaking out because they're a teenager and stuff's weird in the brain. It's not working. And then eventually it clicks. And I was like 40 when that happened. So, it took a while for those things to occur. But what we realize is that if we can understand the parts of the brain that are responsible for addiction, and how closely it looks like chronic pain. If you look at both of these, while the colors may be different, the structures are all the same except for one. And the only one that's different is the one in the chronic pain slide, that bundle of little things in the middle, right here. That bundle of little things called the thalamus. All that is the signaling pathway. It just signals where the pain is. Everything else is an overlap. So in the medical world, when we write for patients for chronic pain and we give them opioids for that, they start having behaviors that start to mimic addiction and it gets really murky, and we're not really sure if they have addiction or if they just have bad, poorly treated chronic pain or if they have both. Who cares? We have found the treatment is basically the same because the structures in the brain that are affected are the same. And so we're going to talk about the fact that that is a distinction without a difference. It does not matter because the treatment approach to patients with addiction and those with poorly treated chronic pain still ends up being basically the same pathway. The goal is that the first part of this is to make you understand the neurobiology. And when you leave here, you will know more neurobiology about addiction than I did when I left medical school or graduate school with a degree in neuromolecular biology. How many times was addiction mentioned in my training as a neuromolecular biologist? Zero. I knew everything about the structures. I knew the nucleus accumbens made dopamine, the ventral tegmental area sent, you know, neurons there, and then we had the lateral bed nuclei of the amygdala, blah, 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 right? So write those down, because we're going to have a test at the end, and you cannot leave until you pass it. But when we look here, what we didn't talk about was what does that mean for a person, right? What does that mean for who they are and who they're going to be, and why did that person have so much potential? And that's a term that I've found that if you have to use that for somebody that's more than 15 to 16 years old, that means they're not living up to it. And so if you have to use potential to describe them, you have to start worrying about what is there keeping that potential from actually accruing into actual. And as we start to look at teenagers and adolescents and the people where this starts, because the average age of starting nowadays is between 12 and 14, right? I used to start my conversations with patients to take a history from the age of 12 and say, tell me about your life at 12 years old. Did you live with your family or one or two parents, or were you out of the house, and what was your first drug that you used? I've since had to move that back to 9. And so I just gave up on that and started going from birth. Because it also matters if mom had an issue or dad had an issue while mom was pregnant. Because the stress related to living with someone with addiction, even if the pregnant mom did not have any addictive disorder, living in the household with someone with addiction raised her cortisol level, raised her norepinephrine level, changed her whole physiology, so that ultimately it affected the baby in the belly. We have research now that shows that if we take in an animal model and we force feed a rat dope, 7 generations later, they still have a propensity for addiction without ever making them touch it or forcing it on them. So there's something that's happening that's more than the DNA. So if we have a parent who has utilized these substances either around or in or with, you know, the child, this may imprint in the DNA to the point where it actually becomes a generational problem, even if we don't have the drugs around them. That was a revelation for me when I started looking at these data that's coming out of NYU and a couple of other places around the country, where utilization in one generation does not necessarily, if you remove those kids, and we talk about foster care, right? You pull that kid out, you put him in a foster care, what are the chances of them having addiction later as compared? It's the same. It really doesn't change. So that's not always the best pathway. So we'll talk a little bit about that, because the moms, the pregnant patients on controlled substances is one of the groups that I saw pretty consistently in Grand Rapids. And it was actually one of my favorite groups to treat, because it was the proverbial, you can stop the cycle, right? It was a twofer. So I'd get mom, but I knew that if I got mom stable and we got mom in the right place and we got all the treatments that we needed, that baby's going to come out in a loving situation with appropriate connection, appropriate attachment, and that appropriate attachment is going to significantly decrease their risk of realizing all of these other bad things down the road. But when you put somebody into a foster care system, just because you want to pull them away from that situation because it might be dangerous, then ultimately what we do is we have someone who has bad attachment because now they have multiple parents and they never can connect to exactly who is the parental person, so they start to have bad or different ways of creating relationships throughout their life, and then the only consistent relationship they can have many times is with a drug, because that's the only one they can control, because they never learned how to control a one-on-one relationship in that kind of a system. So there's a lot of stuff that we're learning about the situations that we have deliberately put people in for good reasons. I mean, it's not like these were bad intentions. If you see a mom who's struggling with addiction, we definitely want to make sure that the newborn baby is safe. I mean, without question. That's like problem issue number one. But at the same time, we have to realize that every decision that we make has consequences, and they are not always positive. So this is why if we can understand the disease, and we can all agree on the vocabulary to start the conversations, then we can start to have a conversation between a parent, a patient, a law enforcement officer, a judge, a doctor, a therapist, a nurse, whoever, and we can have the same conversation. All right? You ready for the ride? Okay. So we need three things to survive. So the literalists out there will say, we also need oxygen. Okay, I get it, fine. Give me my moment. We need three things to survive. We need food, water, and dopamine. All right, dopamine is this chemical in the brain that lives in the nucleus accumbens, and it's responsible for happiness. It's responsible for love. And this is it right here. It's green right here, and it's blue right here. We all have that, the nucleus accumbens. And this is the thing that creates motivation. So when I say motivation, you need to think dopamine. If I say dopamine, I want you to think motivation. Because without dopamine, there is no motivation. So when somebody says, I'm motivated to get better, that means there's some dopamine in there. But if they're not ready, then we're missing dopamine. So those three things to survive, food, water, and dopamine, right? Without dopamine, you don't get out of bed to even get food and water. You know, you don't get motivated to do better when you do something good. Like somebody pats you on the back and says, good job, that's great. And you go, all right, I'm going to do more this time. You're going to do better at work. You're going to move up the ladder. You're going to clean your room a little better. I'm still working on this one with my six-year-old. But the reality is, as we start to do this, dopamine creates the motivation to become better and more connected. It's responsible, along with oxytocin, for a mother-baby bond and all of these things that become really important in life. So we figured this out, and really smart scientists, you know, and like Elliot Gardner in NIDA and Nora Volkow at National Institute on Drug Addiction, they've actually helped us figure out what is the normal level of dopamine required in this nucleus accumbens. What gets us up and gets us moving? And I'll give you the 30-second science lesson on how we figured this out. It's pretty creepy, but it works. So we put in little micropipettes into the brain, stimulated animals with really positive things like food, sex, glucose, and whatever else we could find, and drugs, and they did that, and then they found what are the normal levels, just getting up and doing that, and then they correlated that with a functional MRI, meaning they would take a picture of it, and that picture we could see how the brain was functioning. And then we took what that looked like and transferred it over to what the human brain looks like when it's functioning inside of a functional MRI. So all of this has been derived based on reality and pictures and not guesses. Now, it's hard for me to get a bunch of people to lay down and let me put micropipettes in their brain so we can see it exactly. But at the same time, this has been done over and over again, and we have found that it is consistent. And so these numbers that I give you, while they're ranges, are pretty solid within those ranges. So that 50 nanograms per deciliter is our normal, right? That's what gets us up in the morning. It gets us to the cup of coffee. It gets us out to work. It gets you up to say, all right, I'm going to go sit for 8 hours and listen to people talk about stuff. And I saw in here that there's 4 hours of like one random dude, so that's going to be great. So let's load up on the caffeine and let's get some stimulants. And in this county, I guess methamphetamine is probably available outside. So in the end, hopefully we won't need that. But as we look at it, you have to get up and do that, right? The worst day that you're going to have on a regular basis is like 40 nanograms per deciliter, right? This is the day that you call into work and you like fake vomit on the phone and you're just like, I can't make it. You don't get out of your pajamas. You just like lay around the house all day and you don't call anybody and you may turn off your phone even, which is like crazy when that happens. This morning my phone didn't work and I had to like use a paper map, which is, I didn't know those existed anymore. The dude at the front desk at the hotel is like, what are you asking me for? He had no idea. Map. And so, but that's like your worst day, right? 40. Now what about best day ever? Well, we find that best day ever, you know, you won the lottery, you 2% body fat, and you're on the beach, and that all happens in one, like, instant, and that all coalesces, and that's about 100 nanograms per deciliter. So that 100 nanograms per deciliter is meant to be our physiologic max. That's like our best day. We can still think, we can still not run out naked in the street, you know, and so, you know, like, maybe problem solve that's still not a good idea. But at the same time, we have other things that are pretty close to that, like best food ever. Our favorite food turns out to be about 94 nanograms per deciliter. Sex, 92. Bummer. But I didn't do that study, but I think it probably needs to be redone. I just think that there's got to be something with that. But as we look at that, I mean, we're meant to be in here, right? There's a box. There's a box that our brain likes to be in. It's where we function, it's where we're happy, it's where we're sad. And as all of us know, that normal life is about having happy and sad and frustrated and self-consciousness and ego and all of those things roaming around, hopefully not at the same time, because then that creates more of schizoaffective disorder. But that as we look at all of this, we're meant to move around within that. You're not supposed to be happy every day all day. You're not supposed to be sad every day all day. And the body has been built to naturally do that. That when you hug someone that you haven't seen in a long time, that you get a dopamine rush, and you actually feel that dopamine rush on your entire body. That when I'm out of town for 2 weeks and I get to see my kids, that rush of feeling that you get, and when I haven't seen my wife except on like the little device here, and you get to go home and have those moments, I mean, that actually, you can feel that, and you know that that's happening. That's normal brain chemistry. And that is because of dopamine as the main actor in that. There's a lot of little stuff that happens with serotonin, norepinephrine, glutamate, a lot of other little things. But ultimately, dopamine is king when it comes to that. So if 100 is our physiologic max, what happens if we take like methamphetamine? So it goes up, right? It's going to go up higher than it's supposed to. How high? 1,100 nanograms per deciliter. 10 times higher than what we are supposed to have. Now, the body doesn't like that. The body does not like to be told what to do. It has what it calls its homeostatic medium. It likes to be where it wants to be. It's homeostasis, right? The correlate to that in real life is home. We like to be home because it's what we know. It's what we do. We'll do whatever it takes to kind of get back home, to have that feeling of comfort. The body's the same way. It will move to homeostasis. So that first time that somebody uses a drug, whether it be methamphetamine or heroin that gets you up in the high 900s or opioids or alcohol in the 800s or marijuana in the 600s, yes, marijuana is addictive too. We will talk about that probably in the next hour. And then I'm actually happy to talk about that one. That one's super fun to talk about because there's always some dude going, no way, man, I feel so awesome on this stuff. And I'm like, what? But when we get there, this is where we're supposed to be, is the 100 at the most, but then all of a sudden it's 600 or 800 or 1,000 or 1,100, and the body doesn't like it. So the first time that you use that, the body turns it down. And you will never hit that maximum again, ever. You will never hit it, and that is called chasing the dragon. They will never hit it again because the body immediately, permanently regulated that. And so the body does not like that at all. And even though it'll get close, it won't get all the way up. And then if you continue to use over time, then it goes from 1,100 to 1,000 to 900 to 800 to 700 to 300 to 200. And then when you use, the best you can do with it is for methamphetamine, maybe a little above normal. But for like heroin, you can barely even get to normal. And at that point, you're just using to feel normal. You're not using to feel high. You're using to not go into withdrawal and to feel like you can survive at that point. So let's say now that we've identified this person, that you're one of the 3% of primary care offices or 6% of OBGYN offices that actually screen for addiction. You heard me right. There's only 3% of primary cares that screen for addiction and only 6% of OB offices that screen for addiction, despite this being 25% of the population having this issue. And when we, not the opioid use disorder, but addiction overall. So when we look at this, we find them, right? We grab them, and we got them. Or let's say it's your kid, and you grab them, and you're like, I'm gonna put you in a place to get this away, and you shove them to an inpatient facility, and they go inpatient. We detox them. They're clean. They're off of their medications. Well, the dopamine that went from 1,100 to 700 and now is only maintained because of the drug doesn't have that drug to maintain it anymore. And depending on how long and how much they used, you have anything from a decrease in release to a decrease in production to a decrease in the size of the nerve to killing off the neurons in the brain that make dopamine. And when they're dead, they're dead. They don't come back. It is a stroke in the happy part of the brain. And so if you're one of those that is, let's just say you're one of those that's 20, you've been using since you were 16, so you've decreased the size of the nerve, but it's still there. It still squeezes out a little bit of dopamine if it has to. And that person, you put them into treatment. You know, standard treatment that we've had since 1938, right? Detox and conversation. Work the steps. Now, for those of you who are proponents of 12-step self-help recovery, let me finish the entire thought before you get angry at me, because it is very important, but it's about dosing and timing, just like anything is in medicine. But you put that person in there, and you drop them into a 12-step, you know, pathway, and we wonder why, when we track those patients over a year, that only 8% of them are still effectively treated at a year, 8%. So 92% still meet for an active opioid use disorder. 8% will meet for an opioid use disorder in remission. Those are crazy numbers, right? 8%. There was a placebo study done a while back that looked at the difference between methadone and a sugar pill. The sugar pill was 13% effective. So the sugar pill by itself for opioid use disorder, now I'm only talking about opioid use disorder with these numbers, was 13% effective as compared to 8% if that's the only route that you go. So what is going on? Well, there's actually a neuroscience explanation for this. And the neuroscience explanation is that when the brain is so depleted in dopamine that you don't have enough dopamine, which is required, to build new emotional memory. If you cannot build new emotional memory, you can't actually onboard what? Therapy. Because that's what therapy does, is onboard new emotional memory. It stamps a new emotion with a thought so that you can have an appropriate behavior with a thought, which is the crux of cognitive behavioral therapy, where you have a thought and you have a bad behavior with that thought, and we want to take that same thought and turn it into a better behavior. That cannot happen if somebody does not have enough dopamine in the central part of their brain. And if they don't have that, then what they hear in therapy, whether it be 12-step or cognitive behavioral therapy or psychoanalysis with Freud, is rah, 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 rah. And the only difference if it's Freud is it's going to be more about sex and in a German accent, and that's going to be the only difference. But when we start to look at these things, this is the reality, but yet this is the pathway that we throw people into on a consistent basis. So one of the things that causes relapse, well, the most, is craving, right? You know, people will say that I can't stop craving that drug. I can't stop craving that drug. So we now know which parts of the brain are responsible for craving. It's these areas that are, some of these areas that are listed up here, that are shown up here. You have the tip of this green and the tip of the blue right there, it's the anterior cingulate gyrus, Q-associated craving. We have the lateral bed nuclei of the amygdala. We have the lateral prefrontal cortex. We now have the palladium, which is a new one that we just found that's probably really effective in this. And so we've identified these areas of the brain. And now when I say we have identified these areas of the brain, I mean those super really smart PhD people, and then I'm just repeating what they've found. When we've identified these areas of the brain, we've done testing on these parts of the brain. So we've done other functional MRI studies. So we looked at how bad is craving for drugs? Like, what does that mean to crave drugs? And so they did these series of experiments where they looked at somebody who's dehydrated, starving, and then have been off their drugs for 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, 1 year, 18 months, and 2 years. So for the people who have been without water for 3 days, these are volunteers, no water for 3 days, they get paid a little bit of extra money, like $300 to like almost die of like dehydration. And sounds great. What they would do is they would go for the 3 days, they would put them in a functional MRI, and then they would have them talk about waterfalls, they would play water sounds in the back, they would like sprinkle water on their feet, they would touch water to their lips, and then they would see kind of the craving for water and where that lights up in the brain. And what it looked like was you get this average of about the size of a baseball, right? This relative size of craving of a baseball. And then they did it for food where they didn't eat for 5 days. They got some IV fluids, but nothing per mouth and anything. And then they had them talk about their favorite food, and then they would bring the favorite food into the room and like waft it into the MRI while they're laying there. They would taste it and spit it out, and they couldn't eat it. And so they looked at that relative size of craving, and that was about the size of a basketball. And so we know what we do when we're dying of dehydration and starvation, right? The behaviors that occur. Like if I walk through the desert and I hadn't had water for 3 days, and all of a sudden I get there and there's this wonderful large glass of cold water with condensation. It looks like a Sprite commercial, right? You know, it's like perfect. And somebody steps in front of that and goes, no, that's mine. I'd be like, oh, okay, stab. And then I would move them out of the way, and I would take that water, and then I would drink that water. And that would make perfect sense, right? It would make perfect sense to the person who's dying of dehydration to be like, I'm sorry, dude, I was going to die. So I'm like, I don't know, but you got to move. And if people will steal and beat other people up for food when they're starving, even if the other people are dying of starvation. I mean, we see this in like war zones and in places like that. This is survival. That's all it is. It's survival. So we have, these people in this setting have regressed to their primal brain, and we give them a pass on it pretty easily because we're like, well, they were starving. I mean, they got to get food, you know, and so we're okay. We see this on TV, and we watch it in, like, New Orleans and, you know, and Hurricane Katrina, and then you see these third world countries like Syria and people doing whatever they can to survive, and you're like, well, they're surviving. They're doing what they can. So then we looked at drugs. And this was for alcohol and opioids were the two, and they correlated, so I'll talk about them as one. So they looked at 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, and 18, and 1 year and 18 months. I'm only going to talk about 30 days and 18 months because the size and intensity of craving did not change for the first 18 months. So even if you have someone who is clean day one, their intensity of internal craving is the same for 18 months. They still have that on a daily basis. And so these are people who had been off their drug for this period of time, drug of choice, and they were asking only two questions. Tell me about the first time that you used and the last time that you used. And the relative size of craving that lit up in their brain was the size of a baseball field. It was so much more intense than starvation or dehydration to the point of dying. So this, to me, when I saw these data, it really started to highlight for me why the behaviors occur. And in fact, a lot of the behaviors that occur, I can't believe they can maintain that much control. If all you're going to do is yell at me in the emergency department when I'm not going to give you Dilaudid, that's pretty good control for somebody who's got a baseball, you know, field size of craving roaming around in their head. But then we added this other piece of data into this. This other piece of data was really interesting because this talked about decisional fatigue. And people in criminal justice will know about this because this is where this research was done. They looked at parole boards, and they looked at the decisions that they make for inmates based on time of day. And they found a significant difference between the number of decisions that were made for yes parole in the morning as compared to the afternoon. Statistically significant, you were more likely, by almost three times, more likely to get parole if your hearing was in the morning as compared to the afternoon. And they've repeated this in a number of other areas of study, flight, medicine, and things like that. And so what we find is there is only a certain number of decisions your brain can make in a day. And then at that point, you're less likely to make the hard decision. you're more likely to make the easy decision. And the easy decision for a parole board is to just keep them in jail. You know, the easy decision for the pilot is to just not deviate off of their current flight plan, despite it being better for, you know, less turbulence or risk. And the better decision for a surgeon is to not operate, but it's 3 o'clock in the morning and you might have to operate at 5 o'clock in the morning and I'm tired, let's just get it done. You know, so you get to this decision fatigue where you're just going to do what is the easiest pathway rather than the more difficult one. So think about this. When my patients wake up, the first thing that they think of is, please God, don't let me use today. The second thing they think of is, how quickly can I get my drug of choice? And even if they're having a good day, and they're like, they're saying no at every opportunity, eventually that no becomes a yes because of basic human biology and decision fatigue. There will come a point at which they can say no, they can't say no anymore because their brain is pinging off craving, 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 craving over and over and over again. And it doesn't matter which drug, it's about dopamine. Because the body knows that if they don't have dopamine, that they're not going to be able to get up in the morning and get food and water. So the body's first order of business is dopamine. And so it is just craving, 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 fine, whatever, at the end. And this is why we find that the vast majority of overdoses and relapses happen in the late afternoon. Not in the middle of the night, like we all think. It actually happens in the late afternoon between 5 and 9 p.m. And we have these apps now that people can track, and they actually, it'll alert them if they're around a certain area that they used to relapse or do that, and it gives all these feedback. And with this machine learning software, we're able to find that on these apps that people with addiction use to help keep them clean, that we can find indicators consistent with this. And part of the indicators are location that we knew about. But funny enough, like when they're texting, if you find an increase in curse words, they're tripling their risk of relapse. Because that's that part of frustration and anger and like this decision fatigue that's getting to the end, and you can start to see that play out in how they communicate, and it becomes an indicator of risk. And so we're finding a lot of these little pieces that seem very decisional that are just not decisional. And the emotional memory that takes place for these patients with low dopamine, when they go to get a substance, many times they won't even remember going. So they won't remember showing up to go and get to buy the six-pack of booze. They'll walk by it. There'll be a video camera showing them walking in and getting it, but they won't actually remember the act, and they're not lying because it is a reflexive act. It's like if you drink some water on a Sunday afternoon and you do a whole bunch of things, and 4 days later somebody says, did you drink water on Sunday? You'd be like, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I did. And if you really remember that, then your life is so boring. But because there's a lot of other stuff that should be filling up that brain space. But the reality is, because this is a chronic neurobiological disorder that starts with a genetic predisposition, is ignited by access and use, and then is solidified by consistent access and consistent use, and then is further solidified by changes in the brain that don't allow you to get out of that situation, This identifies a lot of the same behaviors that we see not only in addiction, but in many other chronic diseases. So let's talk about like type 2 diabetes, right? So type 2 diabetes means you're not born with it, but you may be born with a genetic predisposition of it, meaning that you're at risk for it. So in order for you to need insulin by the age of 30, that means that you're going to have not eaten properly, become morbidly obese, not exercised and created muscle mass to act as a buffer for glucose when it goes in the body. These are things that when they happen, those are decisions that are made, right? Decisions, and that are made throughout life. But when that person needs insulin, what do we do for them? We write them insulin, and we counsel them on nutrition, and we counsel them on exercise, and we get them set up for an exercise program, and we send a nutritionist out to their house to dig through their cabinets. And then we give them more calorie counting education. And then we talk about how they're going to count their carbohydrates. And then they're going to do all this crap that doesn't work for my patients because they're like, I'm just not doing this. When it's better just to say, here's 70-30 at this dose and take this and let's get you compliant. But at the same time, we don't get angry at them. We get frustrated with them, right? You know, a little frustrated, but we don't get angry. If they go out and eat a box of Krispy Kremes, we don't fire them from the practice. You know, we're not like, you're freaking out of here, man. You're not taking this seriously at all. You don't want to get well. Can I have one? You know, that's with you. But as we start to look at this, we do the opposite for addiction. We expect perfection in the treatment of this disease. So we don't define addiction based on a urine drug screen, but we will sure put somebody in jail for a positive urine drug screen. We will kick somebody out of a practice for a urine drug screen. We will take somebody's baby for a urine drug screen. We do some crazy shit for a positive urine drug screen. I mean, honestly, when you start thinking about the rights of people that are taken away because of a positive urine drug screen as compared to other things, boy, that gets interesting. Pretty slippery ethical slope when you start digging into it. Because we haven't even defined the misutilization of a substance based on a urine drug screen. We've just defined utilization. So as we begin to dig through this, what I want you to do is start to put things into perspective of other chronic illnesses. Because this is just another chronic illness. Now, how do we define addiction? We said it earlier, right? 9 behaviors, 2 physiologic phenomena. So if somebody does not have any of the, doesn't meet criteria for any of those behaviors as it relates to the use of the drug, and they show up, but they went to a wedding, and they drank a little bit, and they used some cocaine that night, does that mean that they have catastrophically failed their entire disease treatment pathway? No. They party too hard. Does it mean that it's a high risk of them then spinning out of control? Absolutely. But it doesn't mean that we should be doing all this. You know, we shouldn't define them as an addict. We shouldn't define them as this disease. We spend all of our time for cancer patients saying, you're not defined by your disease. You know, don't define yourself by this label. Don't put this label on it. It's you. You know, it's all about you. What's the first thing that we do in the treatment of Alcoholics Anonymous? Identify as an alcoholic and that you're powerless to treat it. I understand why that occurred, because back when the lawyer and the doctor wrote this, they were, because we didn't have other pathways of treatment. We didn't have other capabilities. And the fact that when you have no dopamine, your decisional capability goes away and you really don't have control over it. But to completely, continually re-identify as that disease, there's a point at which that becomes detrimental and not helpful. And so figuring out how pragmatically we walk back portions of treatment that can be very effective if levied in appropriate pathways, but is not effective in certain instances. And just be okay with that and not take it personally. There are times in which medication-assisted treatment doesn't work. It's not the drug, not the choice, it's not the pathway. So when somebody says, they have a chronic brain disease. I've identified them. All they need is to go through detox, and all they need is 12-step therapy. Will that work? Yes. Trick question. But for what population? Doctors, pilots, and lawyers. Because they have a special program in a different brain disease than the patients I treat. So if you think about the physicians group, you know, so at the state level, if you are an impaired physician, you get identified either by showing up or you self-identify or you show up totally crocked out of off your mind at work and start yelling at people or pass out or, you know, or accidentally overdose on fentanyl. I mean, I've seen all of these versions of it from physicians. The difference between a physician or pilot or a lawyer is those are people who generally didn't use enough early to impede their pathway through education, their pathway through that next level of training, that pathway through residency or early pilot training or all of these things that would go on for law school and afterwards and this. But then, even though they may have had instances of it, right? You go back and there's always clues, the binge drinking in college that never really, it slowed down but didn't stop. You know, if they used, they would use cocaine on the weekends but not on the day, but they were able to not use it during the week. But then all of a sudden, they had a life event, things went out of control, and now they started relying on the substance for all of their coping capabilities, and then it turns into a full-fledged meeting for addiction medicine. Now that person has addiction, just like the person over here has addiction based on the criteria that we use to define it. But this person started at 12, had a higher propensity of early life trauma, has a higher risk of ongoing trauma, has used for a longer period of time in the developing brain. has never learned how to actually cope without using chemicals. They also don't have money to pay them if they don't go to work. They generally also don't have a large group of people who are willing to back them up in the treatment of their disease. This group, disability. Like if I had to go to rehab tomorrow, I mean, I have 85% disability, so I'm gonna get 85% of my regular check for getting treatment, right? That's just really common in that population. I have people that will call me and back me up, and my wife will be there, and my family will help me, and you know, my friends will come and tell me it's gonna be okay, however awkward it feels, right? You know, they're gonna be like, hey, how's it going? You know, they don't know how to actually have the conversation. You know, it's like when you have friends with cancer, and they're like, how's your cancer? You know, they just like can't have the conversation. It'll be awkward, but they'll be there. They'll show up. You know, they'll cheer for you when you do good, and they'll be happy for you. And in this group, it just doesn't happen. So I would propose that for this group, the physicians, pilots, and lawyers, they don't need medication, because the data is very clear that if they go into an inpatient program and they follow the script set up for the next 3 to 5 years, which is every night you call and you ask if you have to go pee in a cup the next morning, and you have your whole medical license, your practicing legal license, and your pilot's license held over your head, so your entire livelihood held over your head at risk, those are pretty good motivational factors on the negative side, and then you also have those positive things. They're 90 to 95% effective at 5 years, just using 12-step directed modality, self-help modalities. So, yes. So when somebody says that, the answer is yes, but it's this group. I treat Medicaid patients, and now I was about 90% Medicaid in Spectrum, and now I'm in Camden, New Jersey, and it's 100% Medicaid. Different culture, too. And so when we start to look at these, this group is not going to be able to do okay with just detox and 12-step. And that's okay. It works for here. It doesn't work for here to start. Now, once they're motivated, which means what? They have dopamine back. Then they can onboard that therapy and actually have self-reflection, which is required for self-treatment. Because if you can't have self-reflection, there is no such thing as self-treatment. And so you're going to be able to actually, you know, onboard these things as you go. And so we typically start, or we'll ask them if they're interested in using the 12-step modalities, starting in about 9 months, once they've started kind of really calibrating out a little bit and stabilizing those pieces. So I'm going to talk for the rest of the time, not about this group over here, but about this group, right? I'm going to talk about this group, the patient population that we worry about, which are the adolescents, the patients on Medicaid, the final common pathway for all addiction, as we know, is basically poverty, death, or jail. I mean, those are kind of the three common pathways that if you don't treat it, that's where it ends up. And you either get all three along the way or just early death and all of those. So when we're talking about this group, one of the things that we have to be able to do is fully understand what is our job, right? What is the job that we have to do? And the interesting piece is in this room, we have everybody who would say that their job is actually different. You know, we have people that are law enforcement and people that are in treatment and family members and people that are in schools and this. But I will tell you that our job is actually the same. We may have a different part that we play, but the job is the same. And the job is to get this person stable and productive, right? Not just off drugs, but actually in school, back to work, being a member of their family again, being a productive member of society to whatever level it is that they can be equipped. And so that's everybody's job. That's the police officer's, you know, job in the end, is to make sure that the people around can be safe and be able to move through their life to get to this part. And for those that aren't, they then capture them when they break a law, and then they have them adjudicated here where we can determine what was the level of intent versus is this a disease process that we need to treat versus is this something that we can get better? And is this a person who is a danger to society to the point where we have to remove them from society, or can we reintegrate them? I mean, that's a complicated decision set that you have to think about. And then we have all the way over here the medical treatment, which is, you know, great. I see that you're that you're sick. But we can't just write them a med, and we can't just do therapy. We also have to look at housing. We have to start looking at transportation. We have to look at telecommunication, education. This is as much a part of successful medicine as anything else when you start talking about the 5% of the most complex patients in the country. So 5% of your population in Cass County cost you 50% of the healthcare dollars that you spend in this county. That's a lot of money. I mean, we're all like, we don't have enough money to do this or that, and I can't build this, you know, shiny building, or I can't put together this program. Well, if you focus on those really expensive patients and the complex issues they have, and you decrease that by 20%, that's a huge amount of money that becomes available to do prevention programs and to set this, you know, the stage up for doing this. So focusing on that group of patients. So who is that group of patients? Because everybody has one in their mind, right? They have the addicted patient that they associate with when somebody says heroin use disorder or a heroin addict or, you know, pill addict or whatever somebody wants to say. This is now everybody, right? This is at every socioeconomic level. It is the kids of everybody. It is the parents of everybody. There is no bright line anymore. There never really has been, but it's just made much more aware as soon as we made all of these pills available. As soon as all of these things were made ubiquitously available for everybody, you know, to have based on the fact that, oh, I had a surgery, so here's 90 days worth of pain meds. Great. So I went to Chicago and had neck surgery about two and a half years ago. And at this point, I was the chief of pain medicine at Spectrum, which meant I saw patients in the hospital, did interventional stuff, and was working on, I was board certified in addiction as well. But when I went there to have my surgery, I went there because they do a minimally invasive thing, and I could get out of the hospital and go back to work pretty fast. So I didn't tell them I was a doctor, because I never do that when you go to a hospital, because then they start doing weird crap to you that they don't normally do. They're like, is that better? I'm just going to check your wound a couple more times. I'm like, stop getting your like dirty hands on my stuff. Just leave it alone. Do what you would normally do for a patient. And so I didn't say anything. I just showed up and I had my surgery. And in the post-op, the PACU, the post-anesthesia care unit, which is where you go after you have your surgery, the anesthesiologist was like, or somebody, it was pretty blurry at this point. They're like, I'm going to give you some Dilaudid. And I'm like, I mean, I don't know how it really came out. You know, it was probably more like kind of grunt, you know what. But I didn't take any opioids prior to surgery, and if they were going to give me that whole milligram of Dilaudid, that's actually a lot of medication. And so apparently they only gave me a little bit. But then I get to the floor, and I start having a ton of pain, and I know what the order was. They did this thing called what I call a non-order medical order. And what's routinely written in a hospital setting is, and you can pick whichever med. For this one, it was oxycodone instant release, which is a short-acting, high-intensity pain medication, which is really good, actually, for post-operative surgery. It can work if it's dosed properly, this and that. But they wrote it as, you can take 1 to 2 every 4 to 6 hours as needed. What does that mean? So it's 1 or 2. I don't know who picks that. And then every 4 to 6, you know, who picks that? And then as I need it. Does that mean when I'm also asleep and you're going to wake me up so that I don't have to catch up later, or I don't have to, you know, what? I mean, I don't know. So it's like a non-order. It's supposed to be patient-centered, but post-operatively, there's not a whole lot of patient-centered stuff that goes on, right? It's mostly like, when can I pee? Because it hurts really bad. And as we get this, I knew that that was the order. So the nurse comes in, and then I said, look, can I just get 2 of those every 4 hours as ordered? I'll let you know if I don't need it. And she said, yeah, I can request that. It's PRN, per request needed. I've just requested it, so it's in the order set, doesn't have to do it. So I hear her giving sign out to the next nurse that comes in. And she goes, well, just to let you know, this guy knows his drugs, and he asked about these things again every 4 hours. I think he's a drug seeker. Totally, like, I heard them at the door calling me a drug seeker. And it was pretty funny, you know. It hurt too much to really laugh at that point. So I was laughing inside in my drug haze, which is basically what it was. But the next morning, I got up, got cleaned up, got a shower, got dressed, and was ready to go before the teams rounded. My dad was there to pick me up and take me on my way back to Grand Rapids. And the team is at the door, and they're doing sign out, and I hear them doing sign out. and it's the night nurse who basically just gave it to me every 4 hours, and it was due when they were going to round, but I wasn't going to take it. I was just going to leave. And then and at the door, she's like, yeah, he got his meds every 4 hours. And I actually saw, like, the air quotes happening on it. So funny. And so I don't think we're going to be able to get him out of here today, and I'm worried about him being a drug seeker and just, like, totally digging in on me. Like, I'm one of those people, right? One of the residents actually used that term, right? Oh, so he's one of those. And I'm like, oh, if I could fight you, I can barely lift my arms. So I can't fight you. You're just like, at this point, I'm kind of angry. But I keep my cool because I just want to go home, right? You know, I've been in the hospital, I'm there. And so they come into the room, and I'm sitting there, and they're a little taken back. And then despite being called basically a drug addict and you know, whatever terms being used, they still were like, okay, so you're ready to go? Surprise, surprise. Well, here's your prescription for 30 days worth of instant release oxy. And I'm like, I actually don't need those. No. You have to leave with those. They fought me for 20 minutes to take the prescription of oxycodone after they called me a drug addict at the door. And I still hadn't told them I was a doctor. I mean, they're still basically, so drug addict, oh, no, you can't leave without your large portion of pills to take. And the ones you can kind of crush like this. And, you know, and snort it or crush and inject it or sell it for about $30 a pill for 10 milligram oxy IRs. And so I was like, I don't need it. I'm refusing it. You can write it down that patient refused, whatever you got to do. Well, sir, I just think you're underestimating. I'm like, all right, fine. I'm the chief of pain medicine for a hospital system that is twice your size. I do this for a living. And I'm also board certified in addiction. And by the way, I don't appreciate your comment. But at the same time, I don't want it. And so what did they do? They're like, well, we just don't know what, and they just left it and like walked out. And they just like said, and you know, that experience happens every day in every hospital around this country. Because nobody knows how to have the conversation about pain. Nobody knows how to have the conversation about addiction. Nobody knows how to screen for it, assess for it, give somebody an appropriate thing. I knew my neck was going to hurt for a while. They cut a hole in it that big and shoved stuff into my spine. Yeah, that's going to hurt. Duh. Now, should I expect zero pain? No. But is that what was told to me in my pre-op setting? Yeah, your pain will be well controlled. You'll be perfectly fine. You'll have, like, no pain. It'll be great. Boy, that's really setting somebody up for failure, right? And we wonder why people complain about post-operative pain treatment. It's not perfect. And then we add in the American culture on the back end of this, which is, I want it now. So when we look at this, it's not just about identifying and understanding the fact that addiction is a chronic neurobiological disorder that has explanations for the behaviors that we see that frustrate us. But it's also that we are doing everything possible to continue to make it worse for all of those people that have it.